growing up certainly isn't easy. More so when your father has blamed you your whole life for his wife's death. Needless to say, I wasn't off to a good start. Luckily for me, my father and I didn't cross paths often. If he wasn't working, he was off drinking. For me, most of my time was spent in school or out in the woods with my brother, who was more of a father to me than my actual dad, to be honest. Most of the best moments in my life were spent with him. We kept each other safe and away from our father's drunken rage, but fortunately enough for Barry, he still had my dad's favor. They'd go on hunting trips together over the weekends. Man's work, as my dad called it. I'd be left behind to take care of the household chores, but I didn't mind having the house all to myself. Whenever our paths did cross, it was mostly glares and orders like, "Get me a beer," or "Leave me alone." I could actually count the amount of compliments he's given me all 14 years of my life. Zero. Unlike with my brother Barry, it was mostly bad memories with my dad. Mental and physical scars. The best and worst memories of my father happened the same day. 4th of July, 2018. It was a warm and sunny day in Franklin, Colorado. The town had gone overboard with the decorating, like usual. My brother and I continue our daily ritual of archery out in the forest. I wouldn't let him kill the rabbits that live there, so we've set up targets across the woods. We just started with a carved target on a tree when I was about 8, now we've advanced pretty far, running and taking multiple shots at these little targets Barry and I made.
You won't hit it. You haven't the last 7 times.
Thanks for the confidence, big bro. This time's gonna be different.
No, it's not.
Oh yeah? I'll show you.
You said that the last 7 times too.
You know what? I knock an arrow in my bow and make a mad dash into the forest. I spot my first target whiz by me, and without any hesitation, I pull the string back to my cheek and let the arrow fly. I hear the hard whack of the arrow pierce the target, but don't bother checking if I got a bullseye, keeping my momentum going. I take out 2 more arrows from my quiver, continuing to gracefully sprint through the forest, and more importantly, not trip over any random branches. Speaking of branches, I instinctively jump over a fallen log that's been in our path for years, landing down perfectly. I spot my next 2 targets, 2 bright yellow circles with red dots at their center, one above the other. I load the 2 arrows into my bow, putting my middle finger between the 2 as I draw my bowstring yet again. I pull the string back with ease and let go in 1 fluid motion. More satisfying whacks. We're not out of the woods yet. Well, obviously, but the target Barry's talking about is just up ahead. I continue running, mentally preparing myself for it. I see the shot in my mind and imagine my arrow slamming into it. This is it, I can do it. It comes into view and I draw back the arrow that will do the job. And shoot, missed again.
Told ya, Kathy.
Shut it, Barold.
No matter how many times you call me that, it'll never be my name.
Barry hops down from the tree he was observing my performance in and scratches his chin a moment. He always does that when he's stringing together a thought.
Let's see. First arrow hit its mark pretty well.
Naturally.
That double shot needs work. Your lower arrow is still slipping down too much.
It's these arrows. Couldn't you find any better ones? I mean, I swear the fletching's all worn down.
Bullshit! You just suck.
Ooh, potty mouth.
You are so lame. No wonder Jake Walden won't invite you to any of his parties.
I'll have you know he's invited me to many parties. I just didn't feel like going. I'm too cool for Jake.
That was almost a little convincing. You know, I see all of your sneaky peeks at him. It is so damn obvious you like him.
Jake! No way!
Do you know how hard you're blushing right now?
Yeah, well, do you know how hard you're blushing? You must like Jake too, so there.
Bravo. Excellent comeback, Oscar Wilde.
Look, are we here to talk about people I'm not interested in, or are we here to shoot?
Well, since we're on the topic of shooting, Cupid's already shot his little arrow, it seems.
God, would you... Ugh. If you think you're hot stuff, show me your double shot.
Heh. Gladly.
Barry swings his bow off his back and selects 2 arrows. He motions me to step back a little, and I, of course, comply, after sticking my tongue out at him. He knocks two projectiles into the string and pulls back. The string touches his cheek a moment. He closes one eye to check his aim, and they both make their mark.
It is definitely you, and not the friggin' arrows.
Damn it.
Who's the potty mouth now?
Wait. Do you hear that?
Hear what?
It's a sound I thought you would have recognized by now.
Which is... what?
The sound of me beating you in a race to Main Street! I start dashing down the path towards Main Street before Barry can react.
Oh, come on! Cheater!
I dodge branches and jump logs, gaining speed as I go. I take a quick peek behind me to see if Barry's caught up yet. I see him a little ways back with a scowl on his face. I give him a little wave, which he responds to with a rude gesture. I make it out of the forest clearing, nearly giving a jogging couple a heart attack at my sudden appearance. I give them an awkward smile as I continue on my way towards town. The sounds of the town rise, a usually quiet little spot, but the circus was coming in from the fourth. Of course, my father never took me, but my brother and I would go on warm summer nights when it rolled into town. Here they are, right on time! Children cheer with joy, parents hold them back from running away with the circus, clowns giggle, elephants shake the ground a little, and performers toss candy. I move to the side of the street, a large grin coming to my face. Barry joins me moments later, punching me in the arm.
We are so going this year, right?
Duh.
Alright. Well, you owe me cotton candy for that stunt you pulled back there.
Shouldn't the winner of our little foot race be at the receiving end of said cotton candy?
In a fair race, yes.
Alright. Next time, I won't cheat. And I bet I'll still win.
Oh yeah, and I'll be the first 15-year-old president.
You've got my vote, Chief. We stand there and watch the circus parade for a while, feeling the positive energy of the happy crowd. I look around to see if I recognize anyone. My 7th grade biology teacher's across the way. I'll still never forgive him for that C he gave my gecko project that year. I mean, come on, that was at least a B-, gecko hater. Not too many- Oh my god, it's Jake Walden. With his shiny dark brown hair, his brilliant icy blue eyes. He's laughing and talking to two of his friends. Brett Bleacher, a jerk quarterback that flushed a friend of mine's homework down the toilet last year. And Aaron Hassler, a guy that has more fingers than brain cells. Honestly, I'm surprised that such an upstanding guy like Jake would hang out with two dummies like them. I mean, Jake did break into the principal's office to blast Journey over the loudspeaker once, but that was pretty freaking awesome if you ask me. Wow, he's so hot.
Kate, did you hear anything I said?
Yeah. Wait, what did you say?
Dad's coming home in an hour and he wants you to make dinner. I'll help out. I was thinking spaghetti.
Once.
Okay, fair point. He demands you to make dinner.
That sounds more like him. Back home to reality, it seems. I look back at Jake one last time. He's waving at someone. Me? Is he waving at me? Nope, no way. I look around to see who he's waving to, but I don't spot anyone else from school. My gaze returns to him and he gives me a smile, waving again. What? How? Why? I don't care. Jake Walden is waving at me. Me, Kate Bishop, a complete loser. I wave back with a grin, probably a stupid-looking, creepy clown grin, but I'm trying to contain my sudden burst of happiness so I don't look like an absolute lunatic. He's coming over. How does my hair look?
What?
Jake Walden is coming over here right now. How does my hair look?
Like a bird's nest.
Oh no. Is it really that bad?
That's fine, considering the circumstances.
Considering the circumstances?
Whoa, okay, it looks good, all right? Jesus, you really do like him.
Stop, hi Jake.
What's up, Kate? Circus back in town. Cool, right?
Oh yeah, the circus. Reminds me of when I was a kid. I like the elephants, but the clowns give me nightmares. I used to wet the bed because I was so scared there'd be a clown waiting to take me if I climbed out of bed. Oh, Kate, what the heck have you done, you idiot? You're ruined. Done. Run away. Change your name to Phyllis Walterton. Dye your hair pink. He'll never let-
Yeah, clowns freak me out too, man. Yo, is that a bow you got there?
What? Oh, yeah, you better watch out. I'm pretty dangerous. I take my bow off and swing it around a little, but stumble and almost drop it. Jake just gives me a smile. Wow, I'm screwing up so much, but man, is it working.
Hey, you're Barry Bishop, right?
Yes.
Dude! Didn't you date Hannah Castleberry?
Twice, unfortunately.
She is pretty hot.
She's a psycho. Kate, we should go.
Yeah, fine. Well, Jake,
Hey, before you do, your dad isn't home much, right?
Yeah, why?
Well, you see, I'm having this party tonight at my place. My parents are gone for the rest of the week. Our beer guy's grounded and his old man's hella strict. His house is like a supermax. And what's a party without some liquid entertainment?
A responsible get-to-aho!
You want me to bring beer to your party?
Yeah, exactly! So, will you? It'd be super cool, and I'd be forever grateful.
I'm sure my dad wouldn't miss a few cases.
Kate.
Barry, it'll be fine.
We cool?
Kate.
We cool, home fry.
Hell yeah, that's what I'm talking about! Kate Bishop pulling through! Hey, could I get your number?
What?
Your phone number, so I could text you my address.
of course. Jake hands me his iPhone, and I quickly peck my numbers into the new contact and hand it back. He gives me another one of those cute smiles and texts me his address.
9 p.m. See you there. With the beer.
See ya. I watch Jake go about his business for a moment before I feel a tap on my shoulder.
Hey, Juliet, you done staring? We should get home.
Oh, yeah. Good idea.
Are you seriously following through with this idea?
It'll all work out. Dad won't even know I'm gone.
You know, he's going to find out eventually, though.
What's a few more bruises for a night I'll never forget?
I don't know. Jake guy's kind of an idiot. What do you even see in him?
Hey, don't insult Jake like that. He's kind and smart, and he's like a total 10.
And he didn't die of laughter when you told him you used to wet the bed because you were afraid of clowns.
That was a huge plus. All things considered, I think I did a great job.
You are aware that your face is tomato red right now, right?
Tomato red skin is in this season.
You are so weird. Alright, let's pick up the pace so we can get home faster.
Yippee. Hooray. Hell sweet hell. Barry and I jogged through the woods a bit to get back to our house, and we finally arrived. Our home is fairly plain, two-story house painted a dull white with a black roof topping it off. My room can be seen from the front, and I often stare out longingly into the woods, wishing I could live out there with Barry like Robin Hood and Friar Tuck. I'd be Robin Hood, obviously. Barry unlocks the handcrafted dark mahogany door that I've been told was made by my dad. You know, back when he had a soul. We step into the place that holds so many bad memories for me. You know, like being kicked down the stairs, used as a punching bag. And Barry standing up for me countless times. Those felt good. But with all of those horrible scars emanating from this one spot, it was still my home. At least when my brother was around.
Let's get that spaghetti in the works. Definitely don't need to give Dad another reason to yell at us.
Fair point. Let's get cooking.
Whoa, hey, you got the water turned up way too hot.
Well, we want it done fast, don't we?
No, we want it done right. Start working on the sauce, would you?
Hey, should I add some rice into the mix?
Tempting, but no. I want to eat this too. Where the hell would you even get some?
I have my peeps.
Please, I know all of your friends. There's no way any of them have any black market connections. Okay, maybe Erica.
Hey, Erica's sweet. She may look like a future serial killer from afar, but once you get to know her...
Wow, when you put it that way, it makes me wonder why Erica and I don't hang out more often.
She thinks you're cute, actually. And you do need a new girlfriend.
Let's not worry about my love life and focus on the spaghetti, okay?
Alright.
Try it. Does it need more salt?
Yeah. Maybe a touch. But, dude, we're making this for Dad, not freaking Gordon Ramsay. He probably wouldn't even care if we made a pot of Chef Boyardee.
Oh, no. No, 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 no. This is for us, Kate, not Dad. Screw him. Don't you think we deserve something nice every now and again?
I like the way you think.
And done. High five.
And we finished just in the nick of time, too. Lucifer hath returned. Our front door swings open and is slammed with the usual ferocity. As per routine, I hear my father hang up his coat and truck keys, and the devil makes his grand entrance to the kitchen. I swear I feel the room temperature rise like 10 degrees. He finds the table set up for a good old-fashioned dinner with his favorite vice, a cold beer, waiting to drown any shred of humanity he has left. Little does he know that I took a fresh case of beer for my upcoming party and hid it in my room. I'll admit that I tried it once, but I couldn't stand that bitter-as-hell taste. I've witnessed firsthand how a simple liquid refreshment can corrupt people too when they disregard the whole drink responsibly motto. Dad eyes the pair of us, sitting patiently at the table and waiting for him to take the first bite. He descends to a seat without a word to us and begins working on his well-prepared dinner.
So, any good?
It's fine.
I couldn't care less about what he thought. I was ready to chow down on our hard work. Oh man, is it great! Thank goodness Barry found that recipe. It slaps. I keep my enjoyment down to a minimum, not wanting dear old Dad to pay any more attention to me than he already is.
The weather looks nice. I was thinking you and I could go fishing. Found this new spot I'd like to try. It's just past that pie shop we stopped at last time.
He's looking directly at me with those fiery eyes, but I know for a fact he's talking to Barry. He's challenging me to say something, to ask if I'm going to finally come along. I'm not playing his game.
Sure. Sounds like a plan.
And Catherine, make sure to change my sheets this weekend. You forgot to a few weeks ago. I didn't appreciate that. Can you do your damn job for once?
Of course, sir. Sorry. I hate being called Catherine. The only person that ever calls me that is the demon right in front of me. He wielded my full name like a weapon. The rest of our dinner was spent in silence, and like usual, after everyone finished, I had to clean the dishes by hand. My dad always explained to me that we don't need no fancy pants dishwasher when I have two capable hands. My father watched over me every time as if I couldn't even wash the dishes without screwing up. I've proved him wrong on several occasions. Except that one time when I accidentally dropped a plate and his face went stoplight red. Thankfully, that didn't happen this time as I finished the last one and put it in the cabinet above the sink. I give my dad a quick sly smile, but he just stares at me with his dead fish eyes. He probably hasn't smiled in 14 years. Well, at least not when I'm in the room. May I go up to my room for the rest of the night?
Get me a beer first.
Yes, sir. It's as if his legs don't work when I'm around, but I know that arguing will get me exactly nowhere. I go out into the garage, walking past the site of my beer thievery, hopefully well hidden so my father doesn't suspect anything. I open up the fridge, snag one of the many, many bottles of beer lined up inside, and bring it to him. I, of course, didn't expect him to do any actual work, so I pop the cap off and give him his only happiness in the world. I'll be up in my room now.
Fine.
I walk upstairs to my room, not looking back. My room is the only sanctuary I have in this house. My father very rarely wanders into it when I'm home. I have the sneaking suspicion that he rifles through my stuff sometimes, perhaps maybe caring a little bit that I don't screw up my life with drugs because that's his job. There may have been moments like that where I wonder if he actually does care deep, deep down, just a tiny bit. Those moments are short and few, and usually get crushed after the thought crosses my mind. I open up the battered white door guarding my bunker and turn on my paper lanterns. They keep the room bright, but not blinding. Posters of my favorite bands take up a lot of the navy-colored walls. Joan Jett watching over me and looking like a badass, for example. Random books and old school projects take up my two bookshelves on my back wall. I stare at the stolen case of beer, sweating in a corner, wondering if this was the best idea. People are counting on me. Jake is counting on me. I turn to my dresser and the pile of crap on top of it. I prefer order in chaos. It may look like a mess, but I know exactly where everything is. I snag my wallet just in case I need it, my hand brushing past an old heart-shaped locket. I pick it up for a moment, smiling a little. It's the only thing I have to remember my mother by. How different would my life be with her here? Would Dad be a gentleman? Would Mom and I go out on girls' nights? Talk about boys? Pick out a prom dress? I don't let my mind stray too far from reality, however, as I set the locket back down in its rightful spot. I put my wallet and my phone in the only purse I have, something that looks more like Indiana Jones' satchel rather than a dignified lady's fashion accessory. Then I begin going through my drawers to pick out an outfit. Normally I don't care a lot about my appearance, especially during the summer. Most days in summer break, you'd find me with dirt on my hands and face after spending hours out in the woods. But I couldn't just show up all dirty and sweaty when Jake Walden would be there. I find one of the few dresses that I own at the bottom of my dresser and pull it out. It's a simple, plain, black thing, but it'll get the job done. I set it gently on my bed and dig around underneath it. It's gotta be here somewhere. Aha! I find an old makeup kit hiding under an outdated Times magazine. Upon opening it, I am gladly surprised to see that it's not all dried out. Can't even remember the last time I used it.
Whew, how you're able to find anything in this pigsty is beyond me.
I bump my head at the sudden sound of my brother's voice. Ouch! Seriously, dude?
Sorry. Should have knocked. You all ready for your big moment?
Not quite. Still gotta get all prettied up.
True. You do look pretty ugly.
Thanks, very helpful.
No, but Kate, you look fine. Just be yourself.
Because that's exactly what boys are looking for. An awkward female Legolas.
Okay, one, you wish you were as good as Legolas. And two, no, a guy worthwhile will accept you for who you are. Don't change for anyone.
Yeah, haven't heard that one a million times before. We're talking about 14-year-olds, though. Hardly the peak of maturity.
True. I did some pretty dumbass stuff when I was 14.
I know. I was your partner in dumbassery. Hey, would you mind covering for me?
I'll keep my eye on him, but I doubt Dad'll even notice you're gone. I think he's got the fishing channel on right now, so he's probably set for a while.
Thanks, Barry. I owe you.
Hey, that's what brothers are for.
I need to get changed now if I want to be fashionably late and fashionable in general.
Have fun.
You too.
Loads. Can't wait to spend all night with Dad. Don't fall off the tree again when you leave.
Hey, I've only done it, 4 times.
You know, on the 5th time, you do get a free cookie if you've been keeping track on your punch card.
Really?
Just get dressed, okay?
Barry closes the door behind him as he goes to spend a fun-filled night with Father of the Year downstairs. I really do owe Barry a lot. I'll figure out some way to pay him back, but later. I slip on my dress quickly and look in the mirror above my dresser. Well, time to put on my face. I had what some would call a girly girl phase when I was 9, but my skills are kind of rusty from lack of practice. I apply a touch of eyeshadow and mascara, nearly poking at my eye in the process, and top it all off with a little lip gloss. I stare at myself in the mirror, assuring myself that this is all worth it. What to do about my hair? Aha! I pick up a scrunchie from my dresser top and put my hair in a ponytail. Ta-da! Kate Bishop, world-class model! Well, more like Kate Bishop, idiot disguised as a clown. It's go time. I turn off my lights and open up my window, a summer breeze blowing in. The smell of a distant barbecue traipses in. Ooh, how I'd love to eat whatever's cooking over there. Focus. Oh, right, the beer. Well, it's not exactly cold anymore, but beer is beer. I swing my purse over my shoulder, pick up the case of alcohol, and carefully climb out my window. Oh, dang, this is risky. I leap to the sturdy nearby tree and grip one of its branches. I hang on for dear life as I gradually inch my way down, careful not to alert my father or drop the beer, which would certainly alert my father. I make it down to the soft grass and give myself a satisfied smile. I fix my dress, and off I go. I look at Jake's address in the first of hopefully many texts from him. 132 Cantrail Drive. That's actually pretty close to my school. A town small enough where everything is in walking distance has its perks. It's great for staying in shape. I run as carefully as I can. Who knows the shape these beers will be in when I finally arrive at the party. But I'm sure they'll still be good. I pass by school, thankful that I don't have to worry about math. And unless I bring up the quadratic formula in small talk. That's what boys like, right? I pick up my pace, excitement and nerves powering me towards Jake's place. At last, I've arrived. Jake's is a two-story, standard, upper-middle-class suburban house, now alive with booming music and rave lights. I take a deep breath. You can do this, Kate. I walk up to the door and give the doorbell a ring.
Yo! Kate! Hey, everyone! Kate Bishop in the home!
Actually, I'm undercover Brenda Malarkey. I'm afraid your party is way too cool. You're coming downtown with me, pal.
Is there gonna be any handcuffs involved?
Hey,
you got the beer! Dope!
Oh yeah, very dope. So dope.
Well, come on in!
Jake steps to the side and I step into the party. The place is jumping with people chatting and dancing, cheerleaders in short skirts, jocks in tank tops. I feel out of place suddenly, and overdressed. A hand touches my back and I stand up a little straighter in shock. Jake pushes a strand of loose hair behind my ear.
I got a cooler set up over there for those, if you wouldn't mind.
Oh, yeah, of course, cooler, cool. Oh my god, this is totally happening! The past year, I didn't even think Jake knew I existed, but now I'm certainly sure he likes me. Likes me. I feel a rush of euphoria. This night could be the best of my life. I do as Jake says and put the beer in its rightful chilled spot. People already start flocking towards the liquid inebriator, none of which probably even knew my name before, but now I'm their alcoholic savior and I was loving every minute of it.
Right on, Kate.
You're a hero.
You really pulled through, Kate. This party went from 8 to a straight 10, all because of you.
Well, it's the least I could do. I hear the sound of heels storming away and turn to get a glimpse of who it was. Jennifer Newell, the cheer captain herself, now watches me from afar with daggers in her eyes. I just made the most beautiful girl in my grade jealous. Boy, did that feel good. I look back at Jake and he's a lot closer now. His hand lightly touches the small of my back and I shiver a little. His face approaches me. This has to be a dream. I close my eyes and I feel his warm lips pressed against mine. My heart flutters with surprise and I feel my cheeks grow rosy. I open my eyes, thankful I'm definitely not dreaming, and he looks into my eyes and smiles.
Stay right there. I'll be back.
I'm not going anywhere. Jake walks off for a second, but I'm processing too many emotions to notice where he's headed. Mainly shock. It feels like I swallowed fireworks right now, but in a good way. I groove to the music, not really caring how dorky I look doing it. Time passes and the fireworks show dies down. Alright, where did Jake go off to? I make my way through the crowd, keeping my eyes peeled for Jake. Where the heck is he? Oh, jeez, sorry.
No, it's what? Yo, you're UK Bishop, right?
Yep, that's me. Why?
Oh, that's so cool that you agreed to this. Jake's been feeling bummed about Jennifer all summer, man.
Yeah. What?
Wait, you didn't know about his plan? Damn, that is ice cold.
Sorry, what plan?
He invited you to make her jealous so they'd get back together. Plus, you gave him a perks. Free beer. looks like it's working well, too.
The random party bro points over to the far corner. My eyes follow his motion until I see what he means. Jake didn't just use me for beer, but also to get his ex back. I was simply a toy, a pawn in his game of romance. I should have known it was too good to be true. No one actually likes me. I'm stupid, awkward Kate Bishop whose father doesn't care about her. I feel utterly sick seeing Jake and Jennifer locking lips and making out. I wanted to charge over there and slap the hell out of the newly reformed couple. I didn't. I could feel tears rising, so I dash out before I make a scene. The cool night air whips by me as I run blindly into gathering darkness, salty tears stinging my eyes.
Oh dear! Pardon me, ma'am. I didn't see you there.
No, it was my fault. I wasn't paying attention. I'm sorry.
No harm done, my lady. Here, let me help you up. Hop.
Thanks. I wipe the tears away from my eyes and get a better look at the man I just pile drove into, still feeling a little guilty about that. He's a mustachioed individual with a charming smile and dark brown eyes, staring at me. Oh, right. I'm kind of staring myself. Whoops.
Is everything all right, Miss...
Kate. And yes, I'm fine.
Are you positive? It looks as though you were crying.
Boys suck. This jerk used me just so he could make his ex jealous.
I myself am a boy. Am I included in that statement?
Oh, no, sorry. It's just that...
No, I understand perfectly. I was once a foolish outbreaker myself back home in my youth. We all make mistakes and have to live with them. And I bet your not-so-gentleman will one day find himself regretting losing you. It may sting now, but in time your wounds will heal.
Thanks.
Oh, and my apologies, I never introduced myself. The name is Jack Duquesne.
A pleasure. Say, you look familiar. Do you live near our middle school?
No, I stop here once a year around this time, however. Perhaps...
Wait! Oh my god, you're in the circus, aren't you?
Nothing can be hidden from you, Kate. Yes, under the big top I am known as... The Swordsman. Come by and visit me soon. Bring your friends too. I can get you all in for free. You tell the boy you're having trouble with this, and he'll already regret not dating you.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Dookie. Man, it must be great being in the circus. Traveling from town to town, seeing the country, entertaining people, and just having fun.
Oh, it has its pros and cons. I don't have one place to hang my hat up and call home like you. No family, but great friends in our band of misfits.
That sounds perfect, because home life is overrated anyways.
Well, it certainly isn't a boring life I lead. Hey, speaking of, you better rush home. It's getting late.
See you around, Jacques. Jacques gives me a wave and a smile before going on his way himself. Though I still feel the pain of what happened at the party just moments before, talking to the charming circus performer had a healing property. I'd better get home before Barry loses his mind watching the fishing channel with Dad. The once comforting summer night suddenly turned cold as I trekked back to the house. I can't help but wonder how the party is going, if it's still raging on as midnight creeps closer, or if it's just Jennifer and Jake now. Ugh, Jake. I never want to think about him again. Maybe Jacques was right. Perhaps one day he'll regret using me like that, but I don't need him. The only person that matters in my world right now is my brother. I'm coming, Barry. I reach the old homestead and climb back up the tree, which was much easier without having to lug a case of beer with me. I slide into my room through the window and close it quietly behind me. I'm greeted with a typical sound, shouting.
And you've been covering for her this whole time? You little bastard, how dare you disobey my trust! After everything I've done for you, how well I've treated you!
I don't care how you treat me. You're the worst father ever. You don't give a shit about Kate, your only daughter, who, by the way, will never love you. I'm glad Mom's dead. She's had it easy. Life here has been nothing but a living hell.
How dare you! Come here! Come here, you little brat!
No. You stay away from me!
You want it easy, do you? Well, here. You'll be seeing your mother real soon!
I run downstairs as fast as I can, and I see my father fighting with Barry, trying to get him in a chokehold.
Kate! Run! Get out of here!
I partially listen to my brother's advice, running up the stairs instead of out the door.
What the hell are you doing up there, you bitch? You're next, Catherine!
I dash into my father's dark forest-colored room and dive under his bed, pushing through Playboys and random pieces of garbage to find what I'm looking for. My father's Magnum is cold to the touch. I snatch it up immediately and run back down with a heavy weapon in hand. I cock it and point it towards my father, who still has Barry in a chokehold.
You don't have the balls to shoot your own father. You're just a stupid little girl.
Oh yeah? Try me. The first shot was a warning. I put a hole in the ceiling above my jerk dad, Derek. He jumps at the sudden bang. The power I feel in my hand scares me. I could kill my father right now. It would be so easy. A wave of sickness and uneasiness washes over me, but I try to keep my composure. My dad lets go of Barry. Thank God. Come on, let's go. Pack up your things, we're leaving.
Where are we going?
Just trust me, okay? Barry nods and climbs up the stairs. I keep my eyes firmly planted on my dad, just in case he tries something. I keep that horrible weapon trained on him, just to keep him in his place.
Catherine! You're making a-
Shut up. We're done. You're never saying anything to me again!
Maybe I'm glad you killed my wife. Because she never had to be in the same room as you. A weak little girl that never fails to disappoint me!
Shut up! I point the Magnum at his head, rage fueling me. It gets harder to restrain myself. After all the years of pain and suffering I've gone through at the hands of this man, I could just end it. No. Kate, don't. Don't do it.
I got some of your stuff all packed. Are you ready?
Thanks. And yes, more ready than I've ever been in my life. Anything you want to say before we leave?
Yeah, actually there is.
Fuck you, Derek.
Dad loses it, running full speed at the pair of us, seemingly not caring about his life anymore, just wanting to beat the crap out of us one last time. I don't let him.
God damn it!
I'm shocked and shaking. I just shot him. I just shot someone. His blood splatters the wall and rushes out of a wound in his left shoulder. I drop the gun down to the ground, tears beginning to stream out of my horror-struck eyes. I hated that man with every fiber of my being, but I had never hurt someone like that ever.
Kate, come on! Let's get going!
I snap out of it as I feel Barry's hand tug at my shoulder. Together, we run out of the house and we don't look back.
You get back here! Get back here, dammit! Get back here!
Where are we going?
We're running away with the circus.
The circus?
I lead the way down to the big topping caravan by the creek, their usual venue. Their little circus town consists of a large and classic red and white towering tent that flaps lightly in the breeze, as well as smaller metal campers and a covered spacious spot for the animals. The place is mostly quiet and dark, being that it's technically a new day. I motion Barry to continue to follow me as I creep by the various trailers, looking for a specific name. Chrisholm, Bruto, wait, Bruto? Well, it is a circus after all. Here it is, Duquesne.
Duquesne? How do you even pronounce that?
It's Duquesne, you uncultured American.
Says the girl who almost failed German.
Almost, mein Bruder. I reach up to knock on the swordsman's door, but I guess we weren't as stealthy as I thought. The door swings open and my brother and I jump in surprise.
Kate, what are you doing here? What time it is?
You know this guy?
Jacques, this is my brother, Barry.
Enchanté. Would you like to come in and chat?
Could we?
Of course.
Jacques steps out of the way and motions us in. I go in right away, but Barry hesitates a little before deciding to trust this random French carny with a killer mustache. Jacques closes the door behind him, and I take in his oddly spacious trailer. There was room for a couch, fridge, table with chairs, a bed, and still room to spare. His trailer walls were adorned with different circus posters, most of himself in some daring and heroic pose. He takes a seat at the table and we join him.
Not that I don't mind company despite the hour, but I ask again. What are you two doing here?
We're not exactly welcome at home anymore, and we don't have anywhere else to go. You're the only person I could think of. Can we maybe stay the night if it's not too much trouble?
No one? No one at all?
Our only family just tried killing me, so, no. No, we don't.
I see. Well, do the pair of you have any skills?
Skills?
This a circus, yes. Then you need some sort of talent if you are going to stay.
Wait, hang on. You mean like actually run away with the circus?
Why not? There is nothing for you here, as you said. We could be your new family. Us circus folk look after each other. You'll love it here.
I think for a moment. He does have a point. This is the best and really only option we have. And I mean, who wouldn't want to join the circus? I'm in if you are.
Hell yeah, let's do it!
Welcome abroad. Now you will have to carry your own weight, which includes helping set up, cleaning, and cooking every now and again.
It's the least we can do. Thanks, Jacques. We owe you a lot.
Don't mention it. So, as for skills, anything come to mind?
And we're both pretty good shots with the bow and arrow.
Hmm. We can work with that. I'll introduce you to Trickshot in the morning, and he'll look you two over.
Trickshot?
Oh, you love him. Now, let's all turn in. Early start tomorrow.
Good night, Jacques.
Night.
Until tomorrow, my new friends.
The swordsman disappears into the back room, leaving Barry and I alone with our thoughts. I felt a sudden, immense sensation of freedom. No more Jake Walden. No more Franklin, Colorado. And, most importantly of all, no more Dad. Just me, Barry, our new circus family, and the open road. It's time for a new chapter in my life, and hopefully it's a light and happy comedy rather than like a Stephen King novel. I offered to sleep on the floor, but Barry wouldn't have it.
Kate, you saved my life. You deserve the couch.
You sure? I mean...
Don't even argue. I don't have the energy for this. It's like 1 a.m. Please, just go to sleep.
You got it, big bro. Good night.
See you in the morning, circus freak.
Hey, Barry.
Yeah?
What did it feel like telling off Dad?
Amazing. Now sleep, okay?
Night. I never slept better in my whole life than I did on that couch. All worries and fears gone from my mind. It didn't take long for the morning sun to leak in from the window and dance on my face. I felt a hand tap my shoulder a few times. What?
Hey, Dozy the Dwarf, up and at him. Jacques wants us to meet everyone.
5 more minutes.
How about 1 more second then?
All right, time's up, let's go, up and at him, let's go!
Darn you. I unfortunately rise from my cozy little nest and dig through my suitcase, pull out a pair of clothes, and begin my journey into a new life. I go off into the trailer's bathroom and get changed as fast as I can. I look in the mirror at myself a moment, giving Mirror Dimension Me a great big grin. Let's get rockin' and rollin'. I burst out of the trailer and see quite the assortment of characters waiting for me, each with a similar smile to mine.
Everyone, this is Kate Bishop, sister of Barry and the newest member in our little family.
You cleared this up with the Ringmaster?
No, not yet, but she'll be fine with it, I'm certain. Kate, this is the man I was telling you about. Trickshot.
Looking forward to seeing what you've got. Jacques over here tells me you two are expert archers.
Well, expert is stretching it a little.
Don't sell yourself short, the circus is all about inflating the truth. Over here, we have our local strongman, Bruto. He may look like a mountain of muscle, but he's a real sweetheart deep down. And the best baker in the bunch.
I'll make a great big cake to celebrate our new arrivals tonight.
Okay, it's official. Bruto is my favorite.
We've got the great Gambonno twins, best high wire act in the country.
And in Italy. A pleasure, Miss Bishop.
And lastly, no circus is complete without the human cannonball.
Thank you. Thank you.
All of us will be your new teachers in academia and over more practical skills.
Practical skills? Like what, circus stuff?
You'd be amazed where you can apply all these seemingly random abilities we all have.
I can't tell you how many pickle jars I've opened.
Trickshot, why don't you start with our newest member while I go talk to the ringmaster?
Hope she's in a good mood after.
It will be fine, Kizzle.
The swordsman walks off, Trickshot watching him for a moment before returning his attention to us. Jacques passes by the lively tents and trailers before he reaches his destination, the ringmaster's office. He raps on the door politely.
It's unlocked. I've been hearing around camp that you just added two more players to our game without my permission. Remember the last hard luck case you brought in? He nearly blew the whole thing.
These two are different. I can see their potential, and it's vast.
If they screw up our operation, you're done. Do you understand?
So I have your approval.
They'd better pull their weight.
They will.
You may leave now.
Jacques bows his exit, leaving their brief encounter with confidence. Meanwhile, Trickshot has set up a target a ways away to test our ability. He presents his bow to us with a few wooden arrows. Beauty before age. I accept the bow, take one arrow, and stab the rest down into the ground by my foot. I take aim and fire. Again and again, hitting the bullseye once and getting close with the other two.
Not too shabby, but your aim is a little too inconsistent. You allow your arm to slip just a little after each shot. We'll work on it.
I give Trickshot a nod as he collects the arrows. I pass the bow to Barry, he takes the arrows from Trickshot and works his magic. All of them make it into the bullseye.
Now that is some shooting. I'm impressed. Still room for improvement, however.
I'm sorry, improvement? I don't think you noticed, but they're all in the center. How could I possibly do better than that?
Allow me to demonstrate.
Barry gives the man his bow back, and Trickshot retrieves the arrows once more. He steps a few paces further back than where we were, produces a strip of cloth, tying it around his eyes, and knocks an arrow. This guy is crazy. Barry and I step out of the line of fire, hopefully, and watch in awe as he fires and hits the bullseye. Not twice, but three times, splitting each arrow with the next.
Holy!
How?
Practice makes well enough, but perfect practice makes perfect.
Showing off again, Tricky.
I jump at the sudden sound of Jacques' voice and turn to see him smiling smugly at Trickshot. He removes his blindfold and gives Jacques the same overconfident smile.
Fine. I'll give you your shot at glory, Jacques.
Well, go ahead. Give me my shot.
I'm utterly shocked to see Trickshot draw an arrow from his quiver and send it sailing straight for the swordsman. With a flash of steel, however, the arrow is sliced clean in half and no longer a threat to the Frenchman.
Pretty good, Nespa.
Insane.
Oh, you've gotta show us how to do that.
All in due time. I'd say you're ready to begin your circus training.
Our first week was mostly spent either with Trickshot working on our aim.
Aim a little higher. There. Remember to relax and release when ready. Good. You're getting better already.
Continuing our studies.
Ugh, algebra is the worst.
Wait until we start trig, my young friend.
Or hiding away while everyone performed under the big top, just in case our father came looking for us. Surprise, surprise, he didn't. I was so happy when we picked up and moved to our next stop, Kansas. Late at night, Jacques showed us the route of the circus on a map. A bright red line passed through nearly every state.
We're slowly moving towards New York City for our big final show of the season. Ever been?
I've never even been out of Colorado.
You're in for a treat, and by then you and your brother should be performing.
Really?
Oh, absolutely, but you still have ways to go. Trickshot actually approached me with an idea for your act. How do you two feel about the high wire?
That sounds awesome!
We'll be using a slack wire for your trick, shooting bullseyes while crossing a tightrope.
How safe is this exactly?
When you're practicing, you'll have a net. Don't worry.
And when we're not practicing?
Relax. We'll build up to that. Kate, why don't you go first?
I feel a mixture of excitement and nerves as I look across the two brothers, several feet up off the ground. I take my leap of faith. Well, my step of faith. My feet wobble as I step onto the thin wire.
Find your center of balance and don't look down. Just look forward. Focus on one step at a time. You'll be here before you know it.
One step at a time. I cautiously step forward, slowly at first, but then I start to gain speed. I'm doing it! I'm actually walking on a tightrope! My confidence boosts as I get closer to my goal. Luigi and Ernesto beam at me. I've got this! I wonder how high we are right now. One peek wouldn't hurt, right? Holy! Whoa! Oh, I'm glad that net was there. I bet the ground is not as soft as this.
Kate! Are you all right?
Yeah, just peachy.
That was a good first try. Certainly better than my own disastrous one. You just have to keep getting back up and trying.
And that's what our life became. Failing and falling.
I got it. Shit!
Yes! Almost crap! Until we started getting better. It was frustrating at first, but it got easier as it went on, thankfully.
Brava! Brava! You two are really getting the hang of this.
Now that we didn't have to hide away from a potential dad appearance, when we weren't hard at work, we watched everyone perform their acts. It was truly a sight to see.
Ladies and gentlemen, I present Tybalt's famous circus!
Seeing what our new family could do was inspiring. The swordsman slicing objects down with a flash, Trickshot never missing a shot, Bruto lifting heavy barbells three times his weight. It drove my brother and I to try harder. Barry and I were greater shots than we'd ever been, and we were becoming balancing masters over months on the road, but we'd yet to combine the two skills. Until now.
So, you'll be using practice arrows first. We don't want you to plummet and potentially stab yourselves on impact.
That's a comforting thought.
If you can pull this off, it'll be the best new act we've had in years! When they pull it off, you mean?
Give it a shot.
And I shall be down here to cheer you on and laugh at your many failures. I was kidding, kiddo!
Like when we started training on the high wire, I walk out first, gripping my bow tight as I step on the wire. After hours and hours of practice, it's second nature. At the other end of the wire is a target with balloons filled with paint. This should be a cinch. I mean, I'm already a master of the archery arts and now a professional high wire performer. I just gotta combine the two roles and skills into one. Here we- crap!
Okay, that was pretty funny.
Turns out this is gonna be really freaking hard, but I'm not giving up. Weeks, months go by and we're still at it, seeing some success.
Close, Barry. Very close.
I start to forget what falling on the net feels like, hardly collapsing down on it anymore.
Almost got it, Kate. Focus a little more on your balance. That should make it easier to shoot.
And then eventually...
Yes!
Yes, I did it!
Yes, I did it!
I can't believe it!
I did it!
I'll get started on another cake! This is a cause to celebrate!
Hey, if there's cake, I'm there.
And so we had a grand party that night in our new trailer, many laughs were shared, and a few pounds were gained from Bruto's numerous baked sweets. At this point, I had more great memories than I ever did back in Colorado.
A toast! To Kate and I officially being the best shots in the camp!
Please. Do you know how long I've been shooting?
Some say he was born with a bow in his hands.
And that was bad in the dark ages, so...
Hilarious.
Our party was cut a little short, however.
Ah, Madame Ringmaster. Come in, we are just-
Have you all already forgotten what night it is?
We remember, but we thought we could-
You thought wrong. I suggest you all get ready quick, or you'll miss your window.
Wait, where are we going?
You're not going anywhere. You and your brother will stay here.
Oh, okay.
Be in the van in 10.
What was that about?
Oh, nothing to worry about. We just need to get some more supplies, that's all.
More baking stuff would be nice, too.
You guys don't need any help?
We'll be fine.
What should we do while you're all away?
Someone has to watch the camp, right?
I guess so.
We'll be back soon. Trust me.
It's been 2 hours since they left. Where are they getting supplies from? Arizona?
Hey, I mean, there are a lot of us here. Have you seen how many eggs Luigi and Ernesto eat in the morning? It's friggin' inhuman.
Yeah, but... I just wish we could have gone with.
I know. I do too. They'll be back soon, though. I'm sure of it.
We sit there in silence for a moment in our trailer. I fiddle around with the locket around my neck out of boredom.
Hey, that's Mom's locket, isn't it?
It is. I wish I could have met her. Do you remember anything about her?
Not much. Just what Dad told me.
Wait, Dad actually talked about her?
When he was sober, so not often. He said she used to sing Here Comes the Sun to me at night, and how she always smelled like sweet flowers,
She'd laugh at his stupid jokes, and never failed to get pizza on Fridays from Murano's. She dreamed of traveling around the world, and she wanted a little girl more than anything. She named you after her favorite grandmother. Mom looked just like you, too.
Small tears slip down my cheeks as I give Barry a smile. He moves in closer and gives me a hug.
I'm sorry you never got to meet her.
It's my fault.
No, that is Derek talking. You did not kill her. You understand? You did not kill her. She gave her life for you. Never, ever forget that, okay? She's still here with us. Always. In our hearts.
That's so cliche.
It is, but it's true.
Thanks, Barry.
For what?
Being my brother.
I wouldn't have it any other way.
Kate, Barry, wake up. We need to talk about your first performance.
What? I bolt awake right away, nearly crashing into Jacques. Our first performance? At last! Wait, when did I fall asleep? It doesn't matter. I finally get to do something! Barry, wake up, come on!
What time is it?
Time for you to go get it, we're gonna be performing soon!
Wait, what? When?
Tonight, for our first Indiana show of the season.
I mean, are you sure Barry and I are ready for this?
Absolutely. Have faith in your abilities and training. You've been practicing for this very moment over the span of months. I believe in you. Everyone will be there too for support. And to catch you if you fall. Which you won't, of course.
You're right. We're ready.
We'll knock him dead.
And so, Barry and I got to play dress-up. Of course, when we were still living with our father, we never got to dress up for Halloween, not even once. I'd always wanted to, so this is the next best thing. I felt my confidence rise a little when I slid the pinkish-purpley latex suit on. I add a mask over my eyes and take a look at myself. Dang! I'm looking fantastic! I should just wear this all the time. No one would look at me weird either. Like, I'm in the circus. What do they expect? Ow! Okay, Wedgie, maybe I should stick to my street clothes most of the time. I walk out of the ladies' changing room to show off. Barry waits there with Jacques, looking a little more annoyed that he has to wear a similar suit with pinkish-purple highlights. Hey, looking good, big bro!
Yeah, I guess. Not so bad yourself. But, Kate, does this costume make my butt look big? Be honest with me.
Performance anxiety starts to set in. It doesn't help that Barry is pacing around the trailer. Dude, you're gonna wear a hole in the floor.
Sorry. It's just...
Trust me. I know. Just to picture Dad in the audience. We're really gonna show him tonight.
Yeah. Yeah, we will. Oh, come in.
The door creaks open and it's none other than the Ringmaster. I don't even know her real name. I swear no one besides her does. She never seems to smile either, but then again, I wouldn't either if I had to wear that top hat all day.
Good luck on the wire tonight.
Oh, thanks, we-
You better not mess this up and embarrass the circus.
Yes, ma'am.
Wow. Her and Dad would probably get along.
No kidding. Time ticks faster than I'd like it to, and before I know it, both of us are in our costumes again. We're waiting outside the big top with everyone in the setting sun. The crowd of people in the front gradually enters in while my pulse reaches hummingbird levels of elevated.
You should eat something. It's not good to perform on an empty stomach. I could make you guys some sandwiches.
No thanks, Bruto. I've got enough butterflies filling my stomach right now.
Ugh, same.
Places, everyone. We're up in five.
And just like that, everyone's up and moving, surprisingly ordered and calm. Then again, they've been doing this for years, it's just another Friday for them. For me and Barry, however, it feels like an imminent heart attack.
Break a leg, everyone.
That's what I'm afraid of.
All of us are nervous too, but once you're out there in front of everyone, you'll all just feel like a second nature. Thrilling, even. Welp, time for some fun.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Tybalt's famous circus! And now, presenting the daring swordsman and his fabulous friend, Trickshot!
I watch as the swordsman and Trickshot stride out with pride, Jacques doing a quick flip. Jacques takes about 10 steps away from Trickshot, who selects a few arrows from his quiver and prepares to shoot. Jacques nods, and the swordsman slashes through all of the arrows. They both bow to their adoring crowd.
And next up to bat is Bruto, the Strongman!
Seeing everyone do their acts helped me ease my mind, almost all but forgetting about my upcoming performance. It came back to me pretty quickly, however.
We have a treat for you, kind ladies and gentlemen. Our newest act, presenting the Bishops!
Oh crap. Oh crap. Oh crap.
Come on, Kate. They're waiting for us. I'm right there beside you.
I smile at Barry and try to suppress my nerves as much as possible. Together we walk out into the center ring and wave to everyone. Oh goodness, there are so many people out there all staring at us. What did I tell Barry to do? Imagine Dad was in the audience?
You're a failure, Catherine Bishop! There's no way you can pull this off!
I'll show you, Dad. With newfound energy, I climb up the high wire pole, Barry following close behind. Rung by rung, I make it up to the top. All right, just remember everything Ernie and Luigi taught you. Deep breath. I unsling my bow from my back and knock an arrow into it. A real one. My feet touch the wire with balance and grace previously unheard of from me. I inch out slowly at first, but then feel steady. Jacques was right. All that training made this second nature. I focus on the target in front of me, drawing the arrow back. You can do this. Imagine the arrow hitting its mark, and bullseye! I want to jump up and down with joy, but that's probably not a good idea on the high wire. I walk backwards, heading out for the starting platform, letting loose another arrow for fun. A near bullseye. The crowd's applause and excitement fuels me. I step back onto the platform, and now it's Barry's turn. You got this, big bro. He copies me, knocking an arrow into his bow and begins walking on the tightrope, at first a little shaky, but then he finds his groove. He stops in the middle, raising his bow up and firing in a fluid motion. His arrow hits just above my bullseye. Way to go, Barry! But wait, something's wrong. He's swaying, trying to find his balance again. Come on, Barry, you can- Oh no! He completely loses it and tips off the wire. His hand fumbles around and snatches the rope before falling to his doom. I toss my bow down and act immediately, walking as swiftly as I can on the wire, but careful not to shake it too much because that could mean curtains for Barry. I make it to his hand. The crowd is silent and probably on the edge of their seats. I cautiously squat down, still trying to keep my equilibrium. I grab Barry's hands, feeling his fingers grip tightly on mine, and pull him up with all of my strength. I get him safely back on the tightrope, and then nearly pass out in the process. Jesus Christ, that was scary.
Thanks for that.
That's what sisters are for. They must have thought that was part of the act. Oh, geez, if only they knew. We climb back down from our daring and almost deadly act to bow to our applauding audience.
Are you two all right?
Yeah. Thanks to Kate.
Ooh, I think I need cake after that one.
I agree.
Yet another happy night of celebration occurred later. Even the ringmaster herself stopped by and gave us a small congratulation. In her own way.
Not too bad today, Bishops. But keep practicing.
What she meant to say was excellent work. You two killed it out there. Just no more hero's turns, alright?
Trust me, Jacques, we are not doing that again.
Both of your futures are bright with us. In fact, I need to go talk to the Ringmaster about that very topic. If you'll pardon me.
And so Jacques excused himself and went to hunt down the Ringmaster in the cooling night. She hadn't quite gotten back to her headquarters when she spots the mustached man.
If I may have a word, mademoiselle.
Make it quick.
I think our new friends are ready to step into the other side of the circus. Their skills are more refined and are certainly useful. I mean, who would expect a 14-year-old goofball like-
Your new friends still have a long way to go. I'll not risk this operation on these young fools. One little mistake and it's over.
They won't make any mistakes.
You don't know that.
If it means that much to you, give him a chance to get used to performing. Then we'll reevaluate it.
Did you just make a compromise?
Don't get used to it.
From then on, our performance's stakes kept on getting raised, transitioning from firing one arrow at a time to upwards of three, sword fighting each other on the wire.
En garde! Keep your stance strong yet fluid. Prime, second, tears. Good, good, hey, no core now.
And even experimenting with fire.
Ah! Ah! Holy shit! Holy shit! This was a terrible idea!
Yeah, it took 4 months for Barry's eyebrows to fully grow back because of said fire experiment. The more and more we performed, the more confident we became in our abilities. We thought they were just to really spice up the show, but it turns out it was much more than that. Late at night, about a month after my 15th birthday, Barry and I found out just what else the circus is up to.
Kate, Barry. Kate, come on, wake up. That's the girl.
My eyes open up and I jump a little at the appearance of practically the entire circus in our trailer.
Oh, jeez. What's going on?
Quick, we need your help with something. Here, put these on.
Ernesto and Luigi toss us matching all-black shirts and pants. I look at them with confusion. What do we need these for?
Everything will be explained soon. We'll let you get dressed now.
One by one, everyone files out of our trailer and the two of us look at each other in question.
What is this? Some sort of initiation?
We've been here nearly a year. That wouldn't make any sense.
Whatever it is, it must be important.
Yeah. Now, turn away. I need to change. I change out of my PJs as quickly as possible, nearly tripping in the process. Barry and I find the circus waiting outside for us when we're done. And we're all in our new black uniforms, apparently. The swordsman gives us a small smile.
You'll be needing these.
Trickshot gives us our bows with full quivers. We accept them, full to bursting with questions, but managing to keep a lid on them. The group led us to the Ringmaster's quarters, or, at least what I think it is. I've never been there personally, but I guess I'm about to. Trickshot opens the door for us, and we step in. I'm feeling a tad nervous. What is this about? The Ringmaster's room was a deep red without much of a personal touch. In fact, it was pretty empty except for a clothes rack, a black desk, and matching chairs. The Ringmaster sits in her spot, eyeing us up. I can't read her expression.
Welcome to my office. Please, take a seat.
Thank you, ma'am.
You two have been performing well enough. I think it's time you've learned about the real operation.
Hold on, real operation? What do you mean?
I'll explain it if you don't interrupt me again. Good. The circus is just a front for our criminal escapades. After our last show in each state, we pull off a heist. Not once have we been caught. I'm telling you two this because of Jacques. He seems to think you two can be of help. But if you tell anyone not part of the circus of crime about this, I'll wring your weak little necks. Is that understood?
What the funk? The circus of crime? They what? I mean, that does explain why they disappear some nights, but holy cow.
You've just been a bunch of thieves this whole time?
How did you think we made all that money? Concessions and ticket sales can barely pay for table scraps. Well, was Jacques wrong? Or are you willing to help out?
Oh, well, you see, I kind of don't like doing illegal stuff usually. Like this one time I accidentally stole some candy from Harold's groceries and I ran back in crying, confessing what I'd done.
I see. Well, I guess the old-fashioned way will have to do. I should have known asking wouldn't do it.
The old-fashioned way? You're not gonna waterboard us or something, right? Look, we don't—
Shut up, you stupid little girl. Look at me.
Something weird was going on with her eyes. They look kind of reddish. Like they're, I can't stop looking at them. It's like they're magnets, and my eyes are metal, and they're being drawn in like magnets to metal. I can't straight think.
You both will join my heist crew, and will cease with your idiotic questions. Do you understand me?
Yes.
Very well. Trickshot will be filling you in on tonight's plan, if you please.
If you'll all turn your attention to this board right here, we can get started. I've been scouting out our next target for the past week. As you see here, I have a diagram of the building. For you two newbies, the symbol right here is for cameras. In fact, we very much need you both for this heist. There's a skylight in the main lobby, perfect for our operation.
How so?
I was going to leave that as a little surprise for later.
Wait, seriously?
He's being...
Of course not. Now if I could finish... Okay. So I'll shoot a roped arrow from a nearby building to the roof. Barry and Kate will walk across it as swiftly as possible, open the skylight, and shoot out the cameras inside. Swordsman, you watch the front of the bank like usual. I'll keep watch on the streets. Luigi and Ernie will take the cash after Bruto yanks open the vault.
Wait, is he really that strong?
Trust me, you do not want to arm wrestle with him.
Cannonball, you'll be tonight's driver.
So you better pick some sweet iced music.
Get ready, everyone. We roll in 10.
Cannon, how many times do we have to tell you? John Denver is not heist music.
Well, he always hypes me up personally.
Okay, let me see what you've got on there.
Fine, fine. Here.
Ooh, here we go.
Perfect.
How appropriate.
I'm up on a tight wire. One side's ice and one is fire.
Here's our stop.
My nerves have been keeping me on the edge of my seat the whole ride. Looks like I'm beginning my life of crime. I really had become the female Robin Hood, except instead of stealing from the rich and giving it to the poor, I'm stealing from the bank and giving it to the circus. That's not weird at all.
Kate, Barry, we're up. Masks on, everyone. You all know your roles. Let's get to it.
I slip on my fashionable mask like the rest of the gang, and me, Barry, and Trickshot hop out of the van and into the quiet streets. Trickshot looks around, making sure the coast is clear. He motions us forward and points to a ladder on a building close to our destination. We all climb up swiftly, and I almost slip and fall, like a dummy.
Careful!
Now you tell me! Once we reach the top, Trickshot wastes no time in tying a line of rope to the railing on the roof. He loops the other end to one of his arrows, knocking it in his bow and letting it loose. The projectile slams into the top of the bank. Trickshot pulls on the line to make sure it's secure and gives us the thumbs up.
Just keep in mind everything we taught you, don't fall, and you'll do well.
And if we do fall?
More money for us. Kidding. You'll be fine, just treat it like a practice session. Clock's ticking.
Without another word, or joke for that matter, we're off to heist some dinero. I carefully hop up on the wire and strut along it, at first still feeling those nerves, but then I followed Trick's advice. We're just practicing in the big top, and look, there's Luigi waiting for us on the other end. Put one foot in front of the other, and soon you'll be walking across the tightrope. Okay, look, it's the only Christmas movie I've seen. Hey! My feet touch down on the bank's roof. I actually did it! I mean, of course I did it. Barry lands down next to me and I give him a high five. Step one, done.
You remember where all the cameras are?
Mm-hmm. Crack that bad boy open.
Right.
I peer down at the bank below, darkness mostly cloaking its interior, but thankfully there's just enough light to illuminate our targets up on the walls. Barry takes the ones to the right while I take the ones on the left. We nod at each other and one by one our arrows obliterate the cameras.
So Dina has the nerve to throw away the last box of Cheez-Its. I told her those suckers last at least 2 months past the expiration date. Every brainless oaf knows that. And then, get this, shit. I'll call you back, Len. These cheap-ass cameras are on the fritz again.
Got all of yours?
Yep. You?
Darn straight. I give the thumbs up to Trickshot waiting on the roof across the way. I see his tiny and far-off head give a nod before he starts climbing back down to the street.
Shit! Get down!
Out of here, you damn punks!
I don't remember becoming Swiss cheese as part of the plan.
I'll get him!
No, I got...
Kate!
So that's what being shot feels like. I gotta say, I'm not a fan. I hold my arm as hot tears slip from my eyes. I blindly try to get back down into cover, but God, I'm so disoriented that I misjudge where I'm standing and I slip off the roof. Ah!
Kate!
Look, her eyes are opening.
Dang. I got Bilbo Baggins.
Bilbo... What?
You know, Bilbo Baggins? Knocked out before I could see any of the action.
Well, besides a little head trauma, looks like she's fine. Oh, Kate, thank God you're alright. You scared the absolute shit out of me!
We really need to work on your foul language problem, mister. I spent a lot of time with Barry and the circus folk when they had time to visit. Barry explained what happened during the rest of our first heist, how the gang just barely made it out of there before the cops showed up. Thank goodness I landed on one of the bank's awnings, or else I might have been roadkill. With a little physical therapy from Trickshot, and a lot of rest, I started healing up. And 1 month post Kate's big blunder, I was back on the high wire, and more importantly, back into the life of a thief. Over the course of 2019, I took part in many a heist, and I became an old pro pretty fast. That was when I really started to enjoy myself too, feeling that first guilt trickle away with each job.
So do you really think freezing the lock will work?
I mean, I did take 2 years of chemistry, so I think I know what I'm talking about.
You failed the first year, that's why you took it 2 years, dude.
But then I passed, so we're good. Plus, think of how much I've heard the material than the average Joe.
Just do your little experiment already.
Well, I'll be damned.
Nice job, MacGyver.
Like I said, 2 years of chemistry.
The heist we went on kept ramping up, but our biggest one didn't come until I was 16. Ugh. All right, I'm up.
Morning, sis. Ready to face the day?
Someone's in an awfully good mood this morning. You sure you're my brother and not some shape-shifting cyborg trying to assassinate me?
Last time I checked, I'm not. No, I'm just excited for tonight's big event.
Oh, shoot, that is tonight.
Nervous?
Hell yeah, I am. What if that Iron Man dude shows up?
I think we can take him. I mean, come on, he's just one guy.
Yeah, he's one guy. In a super powerful suit that could shoot a hole through our chest and then grind us into ground beef.
Now that's a graphic thought that I do not want to think about. We'll be fine as long as we have the gang. Just gotta hold out hope.
God, you're being so un-Barry-like today.
What can I say? New York's an invigorating city.
I'll give you that. New York was hands down my favorite stop in the circuit. It always had the biggest crowd, and I was in love with city life. Our comfy hotel room was a great change from the trailer, too. I got up out of bed and looked out of the window for a moment, in awe of how incredible and alive the city looked. My memories of Franklin looked like a barren desert compared to all of the commuters heading to work, the street vendors selling all sorts of tasty snacks, and the bustling crowds just living in the moment. Despite the change in scenery, the morning went per usual. I took a nice hot shower, got dressed, and then the two of us headed to the tent for practice. Unlike most mornings, however, we had to walk a ways to get to the big top, like every year before since it was set up in Central Park. I wrapped my scarf a little tighter around my neck as we navigated the cold November streets of the Big Apple. I smile at everyone we pass by, and some people actually nod their greetings while others are in too much of a rush.
Can I interest you two kids in a fresh pretzel? It'll really warm you up on a day like this.
What do you think? I mean, we haven't eaten breakfast yet.
Are you kidding me? Of course we're getting pretzels.
Great! Two hot ones coming right up. Here we go. All right, there you are.
Thanks.
Keep the change, kind sir.
You're too kind, sir. You two have a lovely day.
You too. Dang. This is really good.
Right? I just want to go back there and yell at his face, I'll take your entire stock!
Then you'd get fat.
But it'd be so worth it.
We made it to Central Park without any trouble, enjoying our pretzels along the way. We got to training right away, no longer needing any supervision from the twins or Trickshot.
You almost got it. You just didn't pull back enough on the bow in the last one.
Hey, you crazy kids. We're going over tonight's plan. You're gonna want to listen in on this.
We'll be down in a sec.
Already on my way, I land gracefully in the practice net below us, and Barry follows closely behind. I was anxious to hear this plan. All I knew about it was that we're hitting none other than Stark Industries' New York base of operation, which is freaking insane. That's a big step up from robbing small-town banks. The swordsman leads us into the back changing room where everyone else waits for us.
Looks like that's the last of the stragglers. Now, everyone, listen closely, because this is the riskiest hit we've ever had. Stark Industries. Recently attacked by some armored madman and defeated by this new Iron Man character. This little event made Stark realize he needs to step up security, so the whole system's in transition. While they load in the new systems, their defenses are much weaker.
And what about Tyrant Man? I don't know about the rest of you, but I really don't want him to autograph my face with his fist.
We've asked around. Talking to the local color, he hasn't been spotted all week. Looks like the hero's taking a vacation.
That's where I come in too. I'll knock out the communication grid at Stark Industries. Even if they know we're there, they won't be able to call for help.
While the brothers deal with that, Barry, Jacques, Kate, and I will enter through the delivery garage in disguise. Stark Industries is getting a shipment at 11:20 tonight according to their delivery schedule, which will now be dropped off by us. We'll carefully make our way to the basement where our target is, and hopefully sneak out without too much fuss. Oh, and Bruto, you'll be distracting the security.
I love this plan!
So what exactly is our target?
We're not after cash. This time, the Ringmaster wants some sort of file.
A file? What's in it?
She won't say, but she knows for a fact it's in Stark Industries. Stark had all of his father's old blueprints and such shipped over a few days ago. We're looking for some World War II file Stark left behind, which should be in a sealed envelope. Under no circumstances are we to open it. Everyone understand? Good. Any more questions?
Yeah, what does the Ringmaster want with this thing? It seems pretty random. All these years we've been hitting banks, but now she wants some super secret Stark file?
I've told you all I know. Best to just go along with it, Barry.
Fine. Whatever.
The Ringmaster has emphasized the importance of this heist. So if we fail, there'll be serious consequences.
This was all so weird. I mean, I trust the Ringmaster, I do, but what's with all the cloak and dagger, I wonder? I shouldn't worry about it now. There are bigger things at stake.
Let's get back to practicing now. We are live in 3 hours.
Time seemed to speed up to an insane rate, and I tried to grasp onto every second. I couldn't help but be incredibly nervous about the inevitable heist. To my dismay, it was almost time to get it started because our performance was wrapping up.
I watched from the crowd below as the two on the high wire dazzled the people around me with their impressive skills. I can't lie. I'm pretty astonished too. Even on my best day, that would still be a tricky few shots. I wonder what the audience would think of them if they knew what else they've been using their skills for. The Circus of Crime is careful, but not S.H.I.E.L.D. careful. I almost turned them in. Would have been all too easy with the evidence I've gathered from tracking them across the country, but the two kids interested me. Perhaps I'm getting soft as my twilight years sail closer, but I couldn't help but wonder what would happen to them if the circus was tossed in Hooskow for who knows how long. For now, I'll continue watching over them and seeing just what they're capable of before swooping down and rescuing the pair. Just like the old days. I rise up out of my seat and sneak out while everyone gives their standing ovation. I pull out my flip phone, thinking back to a time when these things were new, before opening and holding down the one. Fury, I think I've got another recruit for you. Yeah, I know you're on a business trip. You're always on a business trip. Listen, these two have really got something. They're definitely part of the crew that's been heisting around the country. Oh, yeah, so what? Are you telling me that all of your agents are squeaky clean Quantico grads? I'm keeping an eye on these two a little longer, and you won't regret me doing it in the long run. I promise. The girl, she kind of reminds me of myself. Oh, ha ha, very funny. I just remembered why we don't talk much. Fury? Hello? Yep. Typical.
Thank you. I'd say that went well.
Uh-huh.
Alright, what's up?
Oh, it's just... It's the Ringmaster. She's hiding something. I mean, why the hell does she need that file? It doesn't make any sense.
Maybe we're stealing the plans for that awesome Iron Man suit?
Why the hell would the Ringmaster need that?
I mean, who wouldn't want one of those things? I know I do.
I'm gonna ask her myself.
Barry, that does not sound like a good idea.
I can't keep on blindly doing whatever she tells us to do. I need answers. Don't try to stop me. I'm not in the mood.
Okay, fine. But if she kills you, you better not haunt me. That's on you. And just like that, he's off without another word. I really hope he knows what he's doing. Out of all the other circus members, she's certainly the most terrifying. Barry walks out of the big top and over to the Ringmaster's office, not running into anyone so far on his mission. He reaches his destination and almost steps in, but stops when he hears the ringmaster talking to someone. Deciding to be nosy, he looks around, making sure he's truly alone, and then listens in.
My control over them has not waned. They're mine. I know how important this document is. It'll shape the future, like you said. Once all of the pieces are together, our organization will be unstoppable, I promise. I've done my research, and Zola's plans were perfect. Hail Hydra.
Barry hears the ringmaster end her important call and backs up, his eyes wide. As he's backing up, he runs into something, or in this case, someone.
What are you doing here, Barry? Shouldn't you be getting ready for tonight's second act?
I was just on my way to, yeah. Kate told me to ask the ringmaster if she could get us more arrows, but I never remember if Trickshot has a stash in his trailer.
I see. Yes, I imagine arrows would be important for tonight. Well, carry on then.
See you later, Jacques.
Barry walks as casually as possible back into the big top, his mind whirling with everything he's just learned. The swordsman watches him until he fades from sight. Then he proceeds to enter the ringmaster's office.
I think we have a problem.
With who?
Barry, I get the sense he's heard something he shouldn't have.
Leave it to me.
But you know, Barry, whatever he's discovered, he'll tell.
I said I'll deal with it. Go get ready.
Oui, Ringmaster.
I'm in the middle of getting ready for our big moment when Barry scrambles back into our trailer. So, did you let her have it? Judging by the lack of cuts and abrasions and black eyes, I'd say it went well.
I didn't talk to her, but I overheard something important. There's a larger force at play here.
What do you mean?
Hydra. The Ringmaster's working for Hydra.
Hydra? Isn't that some sort of, like, mythical beast or whatever?
Well, yes, but did you ever pay attention to your history classes?
Of course I did. Well, actually I didn't, so I'm guessing this Hydra has some sort of historical importance?
You could say that, yeah. Back in World War II, the Nazis set up a science division to try and invent weapons to win the war. This science division was Hydra.
Wait, so the Ringmaster's a Nazi?
Hey, keep it down! And no, not necessarily. Hydra grew past the Nazis when they came back in the 80s, but some government group stopped them. But not apparently permanently, I guess. Looks like they're back.
Okay, but how do you know it's the same Hydra? I mean, maybe it's an acronym for, like, humanity's youth, drive, yeah, it's probably the same group. Okay, who am I kidding? Oh god, what do we do? What do we do? I mean, I don't know about you, but I really don't want to become an ex-Nazi agent person.
Whatever's in those blueprints must be dangerous. Maybe even end the world dangerous. We can't let Hydra get them. We'll play along for now, and when the moment's right, we take the plans and give them to the police or something.
I sit and think for a moment. How did all of this get so crazy so fast? How would the circus feel about us going against them like this? Would they join us if we told them the Ringmaster was working for the bad guys? What would happen to them if they didn't? After all they've done for us, I feel like we owe them, but what we've been doing is wrong. Upon this realization, it suddenly feels like I can see clearly, like there was something dragging me along, but now I'm free from its grips. My hand instinctively shoots to my mother's locket around my neck, and I wonder what she would do in this situation. I'm willing to bet she would do the right thing. Let's go save the world.
Wheels up in 5.
I finished getting dressed and add the final touch, my mask. No longer a criminal in a mask, I am now a hero in a mask, disguised as a criminal in a mask, but I'm gonna save the day, yeah. I snatch up my bow and head out of the trailer with Barry, meeting up with the rest of the heist group. Trickshot nods at us, Bruto waves, and Jacques winks. They're all happy to see us, and it's probably for the last time.
Team B, you've got the Civic. Kate, Barry, Kizom, we are taking the van.
Shotgun!
Actually, Kate, that's a bow on your back.
Oh, haha, you're hilarious.
Let's roll. Oh, and don't forget those seat belts.
1 on the plan. Steal the delivery truck en route to Stark Industries. According to the delivery report, it'll be arriving at exactly 11:20 in Garage C. But with any luck, it might be a few minutes late and with a new crew behind the wheel. The swordsman smiles at me as we pull out into the street.
And so the fun begins.
Meanwhile, a truck from Newport Postage passes by the Daily Bugle building, lights still on in some of the offices as writers type away at their urgent stories. One of the delivery workers in the cab begins to nod off, having finished her coffee hours ago. The driver, however, is wide awake and jamming out to the radio.
Believe in just one mind beating together. Till the end of time, you know we're two hearts. Believe in just one mind together forever. Till the end of time. Come on, Josie! Woohoo! Yeah! She knows there'll always be a special place in my heart. Oh, Jesus!
Huh? Whoa, what the hell?
Damn, looks like they broke down. Engine's smoking pretty bad. We better help.
Dude, we got a shipment that needs delivering. Just back it up and take 34th.
Come on, the delivery can wait. These guys need our help, pal.
Yeah, alright, alright.
Hey, folks, let me take a look at that engine for you.
Oh, thank goodness. We can't tell you how long we've been waiting here for assistance. People just honk their horns and zip on by like we chose to break down.
That's New York for you. People. Oh.
Hey, what the.
Jacques takes care of the other one, who was standing back away from the man attempting to fix our broken engine. I felt bad for these two casualties as Trickshot and the Swordsman strip them out of their jumpsuits and tie them up. I wish we could have helped them, but we can't reveal ourselves yet. I can tell Barry is bothered by this, too. Trickshot and Jacques quickly hop into their stolen jumpsuits and get into the truck.
You guys, in the back.
Barry and I do as we're told. He swings open the back doors, and we push past boxes of whatever these guys are shipping and sit behind the cab. A small window slides open, and the back of Jacques and Trickshot's heads are now visible to us. So, what is all this stuff back here, anyway?
If I had to guess, probably pieces of whatever Stark's big arc reactor initiative.
Arc reactor initiative?
You two don't keep up with the news, do you?
Not at all. Nope.
Apparently Stark created a new power source and is selling it to businesses all around New York City. I've heard just one of these arc reactors could power the city for decades.
Makes you wonder what we're stealing. Must be better than not having to pay the electric bill for a while.
Yeah. Hey, why?
Look, all that matters is the heist right now. We can theorize later. We're almost there.
Almost there indeed. Stark Industries' humongous New York office comes into view, and our Trojan horse arrives at the front gate.
IDs, please.
Of course, ma'am. Bert, do you have your ID? No? Ah, damn it. Well, we were in such a rush to get here, we must have forgotten them. Well, I guess we'll just have to turn around.
You my 1120?
That's us.
It's against protocol, but... Well, alright, come in.
You're a lifesaver. Thanks, ma'am.
You better have those IDs next time, alright?
Of course, ma'am.
Our truck moves through the gate and drives along the side of Stark Industries. Trickshot finds the open garage C soon enough and pulls in.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have arrived at our destination.
Errol to Blondin. Do you come in? Over?
Blondin to Errol. I'm here. What's your ATA? Over.
We're in the park. Cut the rope. Over.
Copy that. Ears down, over and out.
Errol to Blondin. Do you read? Over? We're silent. No one's calling for help now. Ernesto worked his magic.
Showtime.
What's with the bow there, dude? Hey, wait up! Oh, no!
That's your cues.
Jacques helps us out of the back of the truck, and we get a full view of their carnage. Innocent workers lay strewn around the garage, some with arrows in their legs and others with sword slashes, red blood beginning to stain the floor. Well, at least they weren't dead, but the sight of it still made me sick.
Bishop, you coming?
I shake out of it, realizing I'm just standing there and staring at the fallen employees. I follow everyone as we head further into Stark Industries. I wonder how Bruto's plan is shaping up.
Sir, there's a big-ass guy terrorizing the lobby!
As if this day couldn't get any...
Should be alert, Iron Man?
No! Okay, I am perfectly capable of handling this. I am head of security, after all. Remember? Yeah. You said he was in the lobby, right?
Actually, sir, he's right behind you.
Hello, guys!
Oh, shit!
Back down in the basement, we do our best to sneak around to our location, and I can feel a mixture of excitement and impatience radiating from the swordsman and Trickshot.
How far are we now?
According to our old blueprints, the warehouse should be down this next hallway. Third door on the right.
Wait, hold on. I hear something up ahead.
We stop on our tracks as Jacques takes a peek around the corner. He turns around with a worried expression on his face.
Shit, there's a guard post up ahead.
What? That wasn't in the blueprints.
Well, how old are the blueprints?
Too old, apparently.
What do we do? Is there a way around this?
Not on the blueprints.
On the outdated copy?
Look, it-
Guys, stop bickering and let's figure this out.
There's always the vents.
That only works in the movies.
So, what do we do?
I'll tell you what you'll do. You'll be coming with us.
Oh, are we now?
So, you wanna play Three Musketeers, do ya?
The guard takes out their billy club and points it at Jacques. His mistake! The two clash weapons and we stand back in awe as Jacques quickly takes the upper hand with each stroke. We're not audience members for long, however. A few more guards with guns run into the scene.
Hands in the air, nobody-
An arrow juts out of the man's leg and he slips down onto the floor. The others don't bother giving commands and open fire at us. The three of us run down the hallway we just came from and strafe our way out of the flying bullets. I'd rather not get shot, you know, again.
We need to take them out as quickly as possible before more come.
Working on it!
Barry draws an arrow and fires it back at the guards, actually skimming one of their arms. I find a small piece of cover behind a corner and take a second to catch my breath. This is not how I thought this day would go. Missed me! I take out one of my own arrows and knock it onto my bow. We were clearly in the wrong here. These dudes were just doing their job, but... it's us or them. I poke out and launch an arrow at one of their guns. It hits its mark. Trickshot tries to do the same, but it looks like his guard is quicker.
Hang in there!
Wait, be careful! Barry ignores me, running out from his cover and letting loose a volley of arrows at the security force. Some skid off or slam into the back wall, but a few actually take out targets. Bullets whiz by him as he draws closer to the injured Trickshot. I notice one guard stopping to aim as perfectly as possible, trying to end this fight prematurely. Not on my watch, not my brother. I fire an arrow without even thinking. It lands firmly in his shoulder before he can get the shot off. Barry makes it to Trickshot at last.
How was it?
Oh, it hurts all right, but I don't think it's deep. I'll be fine.
I get off one last shot at the remaining lone guard, nearly getting shot myself. She staggers back in pain and shock at the sudden arrow lodged in her arm. I felt bad about what we had to do. I just wanted to surrender, but I knew Jacques and Trickshot would never go for that. They would fight until those plans were theirs. This is gonna haunt me for a while, but it was for the greater good, I hope. Once we're all clear, I slip out of cover and walk over towards Barry, who helps Trickshot walk.
Oh, shit.
I don't want to shoot you, but I will if I have to. Weapons on the ground now-
My eyes widen, and I almost drop my bow in shock when the sword pierces through his chest and blood splatters out. The sword is removed, and his lifeless body clatters to the floor. Jacques stands there wiping off his sword. We all just sort of stare at him.
What? Would you rather I just let him shoot you?
Thank you for the save. All of you.
Let's not beat around the bush. Guns aren't exactly quiet. There'll be more of this where that came from.
I agree. We need to get those plans and leave now.
I wanted to tell them off. I wanted to yell at them for risking their lives for some stupid blueprint. They're just pieces of paper. But I went along with it because I know they won't stop, and I couldn't change that. Barry continues to help Trickshot walk, and we make our way to the darned basement warehouse at last. Thankfully, we didn't run into any tricky entanglements, well, at least two of the storage area. In outside was a different story.
Wait, don't enter the room. There's a complex defense grid. If you so much as touch the floor without deactivating it, security will flood the area in no time flat.
All right, so how do we disable it? I know I've been shot at enough to last a lifetime.
It's too complex and secure. There's no time. You and Barry will have to tightrope across to it. It's that box, all the way to the back and at the top of the middle metal shelf. The file we're looking for should have a CIA seal on it.
Barry hands Trickshot to Jacques and instinctively grabs an arrow, ties a wire to it, ties the other end to a column, and lets it fly. A perfect shot! The arrow embeds itself into the wall right by our shelf. I give my brother a wink and begin performing what is hopefully our final act in the circus of crime. I feel uneasy at first, but I get my bearing on the wire, and it feels as easy as walking on the floor. I sense Barry join me too after I'm down a ways. Suddenly, I feel the wire slip a little. I wobble, almost falling face first into the sensitive pressure plates below, but I find my balance again. I turn around to make sure Barry's okay. His eyes are wide in surprise, but like me, he's an old pro. I carefully make it across to the shelf and we begin climbing. Barry joins in soon. I feel it shake a little at our shifting weight as we climb higher. I look over to our two criminal friends, eagerly watching us perform our stunt and praying we don't fall and screw up the whole thing. Yeah, about that. Well, we reach the top with ease and find the box Trickshot was telling us to look through. Barry flips through a bunch of random files. Some are Stark Tech plans, something from an organization called SHIELD? Whatever that is.
Found it!
Great, now let's bring it home.
Are you ready for this?
As ready as I'll ever be. What if they shoot us?
Then we'll die heroes. But let's hope they don't. Barry and I gingerly climb down and, to Trickshot and the Swordsman's dismay, land straight on the pressure-plated floor. Sirens blare to life, alerting all the security and Stark Industries of our thieving deeds. I wonder how many times a janitor has accidentally set this off. It's gotta be at least once, right?
What the hell are you doing?
What's right? This all ends here. The Ringmaster is evil. We're not letting her or Hydra get these plans. Give yourselves up. The Ringmaster doesn't deserve you. Do the right thing.
How dare you betray her? After all she's done for you, you ungrateful little bastards.
Okay, he took that well. I'll take care of him. You get Trickshot. Those guards better get their butts down here.
Good luck.
Barry moves a little ways away from me, starting his duel with Trickshot, letting loose arrow after arrow. Trickshot slides out of the way of Barry's volley and draws his own bow. Jacques runs straight for me and I act fast, copying Barry's move and shooting my own volley. Jacques skillfully cuts through the arrows, bobbing and weaving faster to me. To my side, I see Barry nearly dig an arrow to the arm. Trickshot's not letting up on him. I try to get a clear shot off on the swordsman, but it's no use, he's too good. He's close enough to lunge at me, but I roll to the side. His sword stabs through a random box. With a flick of the wrist, his weapon is free again. Come on, Jacques, whoa! See reason! The Ringmaster is using you!
The Ringmaster saved me! She saved both of you too! I owe her! We owe her! This is what must be done!
I block his sword with my bow, but feel him press harder and harder into it. It's beginning to crack under the strain. He backs me up to the shelf, and I'm running low on options. I look quick to see Barry grasp an arrow jammed into his shoulder. Come on, guards, get here already!
End of the line, traitor!
I duck out of the way of his slash, but it catches me in the arm. Damn, that hurts! I kick the swordsman's legs, but he's quicker. He shoves me down and points his sword at my neck. I reach back in my quiver and jam an arrow into his leg. I roll out of the way as he tries to cut me again, but his anger is getting the best of him. I kick at him. It only skids him back a small ways, but I'll take it. I've gotta get that sword away from him somehow. Oh crap! I duck down once again, just narrowly avoiding a potential fatal wound. My eyes scan around as fast as possible. There's not much to work with but boxes. Well...
Seriously, Kate? Oh.
Up for a little boxing? I take a large and, heavy box down from the shelf and hold it out in front of me. The swordsman runs at me yet again, getting ready to kebab me. I move my box just in time as Jacques' sword nearly collides with my stomach. The box is thankfully thick enough for the sword to not poke through and end me. I toss the box to the side, and the swordsman is now just the man. Oh, dang. He was pretty attached to that sword, wasn't... His fist hits me square in the head, and I feel super disoriented, clattering down to the ground. I try to gain my bearings, but my eyes are super watery. My vision is clear enough to see that Jacques recovered his sword again and is pointing it down at my throat. So, this is how I die. To an angry Frenchman with a weapon from medieval times. Well, there are less cooler ways to go, I guess. I see something in his eyes, however. Hesitation? Finally! The guards have- ouch! I feel like I'm floating suddenly. Like I...
The group, now dubbed the Circus of Crime by local paper The Daily Bugle, has been apprehended. This crime gang used Tidbolt's famous circus as a cover for their true intentions, reportedly robbing several banks across the country over the past decade. Recently, they attempted to infiltrate Stark Industries, but got in well over their heads. The Circus of Crime members now find themselves facing upwards of 40 years of jail time, and their leader, self-proclaimed the Swordsman, getting a life sentence for his actions. We now go live from the scene of the crime with the head of security at Stark Industries, a Mr. Happy Hogan. Happy?
Thank you, Joy. Big fan, by the way.
Oh, why, thank you. So, Mr. Hogan, how did the Circus of Crime break into one of the biggest tech companies in the country?
Please, call me Happy. I don't mean to point any fingers, but I want to say...
I wake up in a, blindingly white hospital room. My eyes take a second to adjust to it all, but I finally get a clear view. The TV is tuned into the news station on my left, and on my right, an old guy in sunglasses just casually watching me sleep. Well, that's not weird at all. Hang on a second. I'm handcuffed to the bed, too. Well, that figures.
Catherine Bishop.
It's Kate. And who are you? Wait, are you my FBI agent? Is it true that everyone has their own agent assigned to them?
What? No, that's complete bullshit. I mean, that doesn't make any sense. What, do you think half the population is FBI agents?
Well, when you put it like that...
Name's Barton, Kate.
Your last name is Kate? Well, that's an odd coincidence.
Very funny. Can you stop being a smartass for 5 seconds?
Maybe.
Listen, kid, I stuck my neck out for you. If it wasn't for me, you'd be in juvie, all right? You've got a lot of potential. I've seen you work, and I'm mildly impressed.
Mildly? Can you shoot perfect bullseyes on a tightrope?
I mean, I've never tried, but...
Mm-hmm.
All right, your skills are impressive. Does that make you happy?
It does do my ego wonders, absolutely. So, why exactly are you here anyways? Are you forming a new circus or something? Because I gotta say, I'm very much over being a circus monkey.
That's not exactly what I had in mind for you. Kate, I'm in the business of making heroes, if you will. And I think you're my next project.
You're what? So, wait, you want to make me a superhero? Ooh, do I get to choose my powers? I've always wanted to fly, so that better be a choice.
No. You won't get any superpowers.
Aw, man, lame.
I will, however, help you refine your skills, and maybe one day you'll get to save the city. And hell, maybe even save the world if you follow in my footsteps. So, what do you say? Are you ready to be the next Hawkeye?
Hawkeye? Isn't that the guy from MASH?
Well, yeah, but Hawkeye was also one of the greatest heroes of the 80s.
Then why haven't I heard of him if he's so... Wait. Oh my god. Oh my god, he's you, isn't he? Is that really what you went by? Hawkeye?
I can see now this was a mistake.
No, I'll do it. It's not like I have anything else to do.
All right, Hawkeye. Let's get you checked out. Ah, cuffs. I guess we should probably get you out of those, shouldn't we? I'll be right back. You stay right there.
Oh, haha, hilarious. Hey, before you go, how's my brother? Am I able to see him?
Oh, Kate. There's something you need to know.
What? He's all right, right? Please tell me he's all right.
An hour before, a cloaked figure walks through the New York hospital, knowing exactly where it's going. Room 209. Nurses give them odd looks as they sweep by, not caring what people think. They had a mission. They reached the room, sneaking past the nurse's station a hallway away. Their hand grasps the door and the handle clicks open. The figure enters. The bed taking up the back portion of the private room lies one Barry Bishop, whose eyes start to slowly open. The figure removes her hood, revealing a yarn of red hair. Barry's eyes fully open and widen when they see the familiar face of none other than the Ringmaster herself.
You and your sister screwed everything up. You both will pay dearly. My organization will make sure of it. For now, sleep.
Barry's eyelids feel heavy. He's finding it hard to keep them open. They gradually slip shut again as a deep coma begins to overtake him. The Ringmaster smiles in satisfaction, walking out and moving right away to her other victim just next door to her brother. She stops in her tracks when a blonde-haired man enters Kate's room. Barry will have to do for now, but she knows she'll have her shot at Kate in the future. The very near future.
These colors fading slowly. Monsters on my TV.
Receiving a call from Happy Hogan.
Ah, great. What is it this time?
Putting him through now, sir.
No, wait, don't!
Mr. Stark!
Hi, Happy. What can I do for you?
Sir, have you seen the news recently?
I've been a little busy, actually.
Stark Industries was attacked. Again. See, sir, I told you we should have staggered up on those upgrades better. They blew past it all so easily. It's honestly embarrassing. And I'm pretty sure there was like a 13-year-old girl that was part of the heist crew. I'm like, who does that?
Jarvis! Why didn't you tell me about this?
I was never alerted, sir. Apologies.
Damn. Either our security system's shit, or these guys were good.
No, yeah, it sucks. It really does, Mr. Stark.
Well, Happy, it sounds like you've got a lot of work ahead of you. I'll leave you to it, then.
Oh, Mr. Stark, before you go, I actually got to be interviewed on TV. I mean, how cool was that? And you know that hot nude woman that you're always watching, Joy Mercado? I actually got to talk to her for a full 3 minutes. And, I mean, I asked her out at the end of it, but she... Wait, Mr. Stark? You still there? Mr. Stark, I... Good going, Hogan. Make the boss happy. Or you. Whatever.